This is another Black Sun Syndicate Star Wars Destiny video. I'm your host, Bradley Reeves. Today we are going to be going over the blue or force user cards in the Awakening set. In the previous video that I did, we talked about the red cards, the command cards. So you'll notice to my right, I have each of the previews for all the blue cards. We're going to start with Count Dooku. You got to have a Christopher Lee card in here. One of the great villains of our time. Dooku has 10 health, which normally is average for a unique character, but believe me, it's actually a lot higher than 10. He costs 11 for normal version, 15 for an elite, so he's very affordable. He has a couple of melee damage sides, a one melee, a two melee, a focus, a two discard for a resource, one resource, and a blank. Now, the reason you're running a card like Dooku is for this ability. Before this character is dealt one or more damage, you may discard a card from hand to give him one shield. This is a very potent ability. It makes damaging him much more difficult. It does cost you cards in hand, so there's a sort of a restriction. Eventually you will run out of cards, but he's a very tough nut to crack. His damage sides are fair, but you'd like to have another damage side to be an aggressive character. But he's more of a defensive character, very hard to kill. And one of my suggestions from the first video is to pair him with somebody like General Grievous, who we all know they had a quite a working relationship during the Clone Wars. So it's thematical at the very least. You're going to see Dooku a lot because of his full-on defensive capabilities. Usually paired with somebody like Grievous or Kylo Ren. As you can get an elite version of Dooku along with an elite version of Kylo Ren for under 30 points. And you can get an elite Grievous with a normal Dooku without too much of a problem. Next up is the Dark Lord of the Sith, Darth Vader. So Vader has 13 health, the highest of any one character in the game. His normal version is 16 points. His elite is 21 points. That is the most expensive single character in the game. Obviously, he is a villain card and he is legendary. The color in the bottom right hand corner denotes which rarity type he is. Purple is legendary, green is rare, yellow is uncommon, and blue is common. His dice on the left side, 2 and 3 melee damage, respectively, 2 disrupt, 1 shield, 1 resource, 1 blank. After you activate this character, you may force an opponent to choose and discard a card from their hand. So, Vader is expensive. He has the health to back it up. His melee dice, again, two and three are above, are two is an average, three is above average on damage. Every time you activate him, you get to force your opponent to choose and discard a card. So Vader's working toward two different win conditions. One is decking your opponent or having no cards left available. And the other is massive damage. Now, the biggest problem with Vader is his cost restrictions. 16 and 21 are extremely high. Usually 16 will get you, some of the characters you can get an elite version for 16 or less. For this, you just get, a normal version, and that's it. And 21, there's only three characters that you could pair with Vader if you did an elite Vader, and that is one of the three non-uniques on the villain side. That's it. Certainly the numbers, on his card suggest that he's worth it. I have seen some players play a Vader, Tusken Raider deck, and it'd be strong. I have not personally tried that deck. I've been trying a few more, interesting decks. So, Vader is a character that I really don't have a strong opinion if he's overcosted for what he has, or if the reason that they costed him this is because he's so powerful. Now, an elite Vader with a lightsaber, a force choke, and a mind probe. You know, we're starting to do some healthy damage. Now his output, his damage output, is stronger than every other villain force character that they currently have. But I'm really hesitant about his costs. Because the elite version is so expensive. Now his grandson, Kylo Ren, has 11 health, which is above average. His normal version costs 10, and his elite version costs 13, so he's extremely affordable. Now, Kylo's got three different damage sides. He has a one melee, two melee for a resource, and a special. Choose an opponent's character, then look at a random card in that opponent's hand, and deal damage to that character equal to the cost of the card you just looked at. So what, so from an aggressive standpoint, while Kylo's one and two melee are at or below average, it's his special is truly painful. So all those high cost cards we were talking about, the high cost supports, and even the high cost upgrades, they certainly can backfire when you have Kylo in play. And especially if you roll a special and your opponent can't deal with it, they have to find a way to get that card out of their hand or suffer the consequences. That type of sub-game, to me, is one of the reasons that Destiny is so special. Now, my history, I've played Magic the Gathering, and one of the cards that was the simplest, and what's still one of my favorite cards, is a card called Cursed Scroll. It was a one-cost artifact. You paid three and tapped it and named a card. And you targeted a creature or player. Your opponent would choose one of the cards at random from your hand. And if the card was, if the named card was revealed, then you got to deal two damage to target creature or player. So the reason that was interesting was you could clearly name a card that wasn't even in their hand, make them think you had that card in your hand, and they would have to play around it. So that kind of card had an interesting sub-game with it. I see Kylo Ren in a very similar light. Now, he is a starter deck card. You will get, in his starter, you get him as well as two copies of his dice. So you can play him either as a normal or an elite. 13 for an elite is very cheap. As a matter of fact, other than his counterpart on the light side, he's the cheapest elite villain character that they printed in Awakening. So he has the potential for a lot of high damage effects. Now, Vader's is more fixed damage output, where Kylo's is a little more random. But your opponent's going to have some expensive cards in their deck, so it will. And if your opponent's playing against, if you're playing against a Poe Dameron deck where they're trying to go big on you, that's gonna get real interesting with Kylo Ren. Alright, next up we have the non-unique villain character in this set. It is Night Sister. 7 health for 8 cost. The Night Sister has 2 damage sides, a 1 ranged and a 2 ranged, a discard, a disrupt, and a resource. Her action is to reroll a die and then deal 1 damage to this character. Now, dice control or dice manipulation is a very important aspect of the game. Being able to reroll a die, and this can be yours or your opponent's, does not matter who, for a damage, is an incredibly powerful effect. And again, damage, you can absorb damage with shield. So if you have a shield on her, you get to take an action to reroll a die. So it's certainly that type of an effect that you would want in a deck. It gives you a reroll, or let you reroll an opponent's die. And you can start an elite Kylo and 2 Night Sisters for 29 points. So that's an interesting team. Now, being all blue or all force users will restrict you in card pool which you may or may not want. But it has some interesting dynamics with two different characters being able to allow rerolls. All right, Force Choke. Two resources for a blue character only upgrade for villains. It is legendary. Its die is two disrupt, one discard, one resource, two special sides, and a blank. The special sides deal one unblockable damage to another character. Then you may turn one of its character or upgrade dice to any side. So, Force Choke is a control card in one respect. Between the disrupt, the discard, and the ability that also deals unblockable damage, which, as we know, goes through shields, all for the nice low cost of two. That's a very effective card. Something that is a, like I said, very powerful effect for its cost. It gives another control element in, say, a Vader deck, where you're trying to control your opponent as much as possible while you're discarding their hand, while you're pumping out damage. Shows that Vader is not to be messed with. Immobilize. Two cost upgrade, also a blue character only. It has a disrupt, three different shield sides, a resource, and a blank. And as an action, you may remove this die to turn a die to his side showing a blank. As a villain only rare, and as I recall, a copy of this comes in the starter deck. Immobilizes is a very good defensive card. Having three different shield sides that produce shields, as well as having an action that allows you to manipulate a die, is incredibly strong. If you don't roll what you want with Immobilize and you don't want to re-roll it, you have the option to change one of your opponent's dice showing something important to a blank. Showing, again, more of the control aspect that the dark side can play. Kylo Ren's lightsaber. This is a unique upgrade. Again, this is a blue character only. For villains, it is legendary. Three cost. It has four different damage sides. Three damage for a resource, plus two melee, plus three melee, and the special deal two damage to a character. If any of this damage is blocked by shields, re-roll this die instead of removing it from your pool. This is an incredible damage producer. Four different sides that produce damage is very high. That's two-thirds of your rolls of this die, of the sides on this die, are damage. Two of them are a little more restrictive. Well, three of them are restrictive, one by the number of resources you have, the other two by did you hit another melee? And then the special is just a shield-eating machine. We're going to come to some characters, especially light side characters. They're going to be very good at adding shield after shield after shield, obviously to a maximum of three at any one time on a character. In something like Kylo Ren's lightsaber, can hit into their shields, re-roll back into the pool, hit them again into their shields, and re-roll back in the pool. So you can do six damage, which is the first two hit shields. The third one or the second special hits a shield and a point of damage. You re-roll it again, and you could hit it again. So the potential damage output of this lightsaber is great. I would certainly not be hurting to at least play one of these in your Force users deck. Now the card that a lot of players considered overpowered. It's certainly a rare that players saw early. So we're glad that there are ways to deal with it now. The Sith Holocron. The Holocron has a cost zero resources. It has two blanks, a focus, a plus one resource, and then the reason you're running it is it's special that's on two sides. As a special, you get to switch this upgrade with a blue ability upgrade in your hand, ignoring play restrictions. So, you get to play a blue upgrade from your hand onto a character, no matter what the character, no matter what the card in your hand said. And then you may spend one resource to roll its die into your pool if able. So I can swap the Sith Holocron with Kylo Ren's lightsaber on a character that's already activated for the turn. Which is kind of obvious with a Sith Holocron. Save myself three resources to put it into play. I don't have to pay that, and then I just spend one resource to roll this die into the pool. And then I can place Sith Holocron on another character that's not been activated and get another activation of it this turn. Yeah, I can see why players have screamed about it. Now, obviously, since that point, we have seen a good number of cards and ways to circumvent some of this. So it's not quite as powerful as it was, but I still think it's one of those cards that you probably gonna want two copies of for your Force users or Force user slash whatever color deck. Now we get into the hero side. Luke Skywalker, Jedi Knight. 12 health is the highest on the light side for blue characters. He costs 15 for normal, 20 for elite. He has a two melee, a three melee, a focus, a shield, and a resource, and a blank. And after you activate this character, draw a card. Luke and Darth Vader are basically mirror images of one another. with Luke, you get to draw a card when you activate him. Vader, you get to force your opponent to discard a card. Now, the problem with this, a problem with Luke is, so again, he is cost restrictive. The 15 and the 20 limit what you can play for, you know, on your team. 15 is the highest normal, and 20 is the highest unique for the light side. For an elite character, so it really waters down your abilities on your starting team. He does have a 2 and a 3 damage side, which is very powerful. The question is, how useful is the after you activate this character, draw a card bit? Again, Destiny is another one of the is a game where at the end of your turn you get to draw back up to your hand size, which is 5. So running out of cards in your hand on a single turn, sure, you only have so many cards for that particular turn. Where you run into issues is, as the longer the game goes with Luke, the more you activate him, the deeper you get in your deck, and unfortunately, at some point, this ability is going to be blank. And it's actually, you are sitting in a situation, I have no more cards in the deck, I only have 3 or 4 cards left in my hand. Once these are gone, the game's over. I'm done. So right now, I have to question what to do with Luke. As much as I like Luke as a character in the Star Wars universe, I'm not sure where he fits right now with the light side. Again, I'm sorry for some of the screenshots. The Destiny Shapers Star Wars Facebook group helped with some of these, get some of these images for me, and so some of them are not of the greatest quality, but I used the best that I could. So the Padawan is the non-unique for the light side. 7 health for 8 cost. They have 3 damage sides. All melee, a focus, a resource, and a blank. And while this character does not have an upgrade, the cost to attach a weapon to it is decreased by 1. So, as a non-unique character, this one is actually a little above average. The health is low, but I think all the non-unique health, all the non-unique characters' healths are on the low side. What sets Padawan apart is the fact that it has 3 different damage sides, a focus, which is fairly useful in fixing a die where you need it, and the ability to drop a weapon on it for 1 less if it doesn't have an upgrade. I mean, it's very strong. I really like it. It's a very nice non-unique. Now, of course, we saw Luke, who was 20 points. You could have an elite Luke and a Padawan in play. That's quite a few damage sides on 3 dice. If you're in the market for a non-unique, Padawan is a fine choice. Now it decreases the cost of any weapon that goes on it. So it doesn't matter what color the weapon is. Okay, now we come to the character that I think is the best light side character, light side force user, and that's Qui-Gon Jinn. Qui-Gon has 11 health. He has two damage sides, two shield sides, a resource, and a blank. His basic is 13. His elite is 17. And before this character gains one or more shields, you may remove one of his shields to deal one damage to a character. So, theoretically, because of his ability, he technically has four sides that are damage sides. The one melee, the two melee, the one shield, and the two shields. So that's bonus number one. Number two, his health may be 11, which is slightly above average, a little below Luke's. But with his ability, you're going to be, you're going to fo you, most of the time, you're going to focus on a shield heavy or protective heavy style deck, where gaining shields allows you to, where you can burn off a shield to do a damage and then put, while putting more shields on. So you're constantly recycling that. To me, Qui-Gon is the best light side force user in in set one. And then there's Rey. So Rey's is also ridiculous. They play in two. They honestly play in two different style decks. To me, Rey is an aggressive card, and she's got 10 health, which is on the low side. But she has she has two, or she has a. She has two sides that can do damage, a discard side, two sides that can gain resources, and a blank. What makes Rey special is her costs 9 for a normal version, 12 for an elite version. And after you play an upgrade on this character, you may take one additional action. That ability is what makes Rey special. Again, as I said in the first video with the red characters, multiple additional actions will eventually gain you a tempo advantage, where you can do things where your opponent doesn't get the opportunity to react between actions is a big step. Now Rey is a starter deck card. Again, just like Kylo Ren, you'll get two copies of her dice. And a 12-point elite is by far the cheapest elite you're gonna find in set one. Now, while Qui-Gon fits a defensive style deck that allows you to ping everything while staying shielded up, Rey fits an aggressive style deck that's playing lots of upgrades that are adding that are constantly adding dice. I know that a lot of players, when they went to their release events, were choosing the Rey deck over the Kylo deck because she is such a tempo card. This ability on her is why. Yes, the plus two melee, the plus one resource sometimes feel like a blank because of the you may not have the right attachments, you may not roll the correct dice on her. But having the ability to just continually put an upgrade on her and then take an additional action is ridiculous. Now, a card we'll get into when we go over the gray-colored and battlefield cards is a wonderful thing called the Holdout Blaster. And the Holdout Blaster has Ambush. So what happens if you play an Ambush card on Rey? Well, then she gets two additional actions. One for the ambush and one for her trait. So playing a Holdout Blaster on her, you can then activate her, roll all the dice for her and her upgrades into the pool, and then you can resolve a die. So you can see where she gets incredibly stupid as far as that goes, broken in that level. Qui-Gon's a different level broken as far as a unique and the defensive side. Rey is the, in my opinion, the aggressive MVP on the hero side, because she is just that powerful. So now we're going to get into some of the upgrades. Force protection, 3 cost, blue character only, hero. It has a disrupt, a discard, a resource, and 2 specials along with a blank. The specials are give 3 shields to your characters distributed as you wish. You know that Qui-Gon Jinn card I was talking about earlier? More ways to give shields where I can protect my other character. Say as a Qui-Gon Jinn Padme Amidala deck. And by the way, that one's pretty fun that I have tried. It's hard to go through all those shields, by the way. So, yeah, if you're looking for a control card in a hero-based deck as an upgrade, this is certainly one of those cards that can do that. Jedi Robes. This is a rare, but it's also in the starter deck. It's Rey deck. It is 2 cost upgrade equipment. It has 2 different focus sides, a disrupt, 2 different resource sides, a blank, and then when you play this upgrade, give attached character 1 shield or 2 shields instead if it's the first round of the game. So it's in, especially in the starter decks, this is a nice equipment for the starter decks. It basically gives you, even if you're not in the market for some of the rolls on that dice, it does give you 1 or 2 shields for 2 resources. Now, you remember the rulebook ability where you can discard an equipment to play one of the reduced cost. Well, there's cards that will let you return equipment to the top of your deck so that you can use it turn after, you know, you do that turn after turn after turn. I could see this getting abused in some shape or form that way as well. Luke Skywalker's lightsaber. This is another hero unique, blue character only. 3 cost. It has 3 different damage sides. 3 melee damage for a resource, plus 3 melee, and then it has a special ability, which you can either give a character 2 shields or deal 2 unblockable damage to a character. Yeah, it also has the other sides of two shields and a resource as well. Again, similar to Kylo Ren's lightsaber, this one isn't quite as powerful as Kylo Ren's, but overall, this is a very good, unique lightsaber. It's certainly one that I would run. It gives you, three different sides that can deal damage is great. It's got two sides that can give shields. So even somebody like Qui-Gon's may be in the market for this, Rey even. So it can, it's sort of multi-purpose in that regard. And the ones that are very flexible are going to see more play in those decks where you need it to be one or the other at any point in time. Next up is One with the Force. It is a 4-cost upgrade. Blue character only. Hero only. Legendary. It has no blank sides. It can do 3 ranged, 2 focus, 3 focus, 3 disrupt, 2 shield, 2 resources. So right now it has one of the higher outputs in the entire game. Before attached character is defeated, this upgrade becomes a support for the rest of the game. And it starts ready, which means if you've already activated the character for the turn, rolled a die, resolved the die, then when your character dies, this just becomes a support, and you can immediately roll it back into the pool. That is some fantastic. That's some fantastic stuff. Now, yes, 4 is expensive, so you're probably going to have to discard one of your other upgrades. But I don't think Rey will care if you put it on her, because she'll just take another action anyway. I'm not 100% sure that you're going to be able to play 2 of these in your deck. Although, again, as I keep thinking about Rey, it's certainly a possibility. Now, this technically has less aggressive written on it, but if you can hit somebody for 3 ranged, that's a good chunk. Just make sure if you're playing this that you make Obi-Wan proud when you roll it. Now let's talk about one of the most impressive cards from the starter decks. This is Force Throw. It is a neutral card that costs 3. It's an upgrade, blue character only. It has a ranged damage side and a blank, as well as 2 disrupt sides. But what you're playing it for is the special. Remove a die to deal a character damage equal to the value showing on that die. Specials and blanks are 0. Now it says remove a die to deal a character damage. So I get to resolve my die and basically resolve your 3 melee and deal it to whatever character I want. Sold. Yeah, you're going to want, if you're playing a Force user deck, you want 2 copies of this card. It's just bonkers. Because it's technically dealing 2 things. You're removing one of your opponent's dice, and you're dealing damage to one of their characters with it. I mean, even for three resources, it is clearly worth it. And because of the upgrade discount costs that you have built into the game, it's just ridiculous. Yeah, you'll be seeing Force Throw a lot. Force Training. This is also a neutral card. Cost 2. It's also an upgrade to play Spot a Blue character. So this can go on anybody. It has a couple of damage sides, a focus side, a resource, a blank, and then special. It lets you choose 2 of the following. Deal 1 damage to a character, gain 1 resource, or gain a shield. So this card is sort of the Swiss Army tool of upgrades. It does a little bit of everything, and the special side does a lot. It's flexible. It's costed right too, is right in that spot where, yes, it can cost you a whole turn's worth of resources, or you can discard an upgrade to reduce it by, you know. So there's a lot of potential in this card, and I see a lot of flexibility. So once you get beyond your weapons, something like this that's flexible in all slots may be something that you're in the market for, because it does so many different things. A lot of my favorite decks in other games has those type of Swiss Army knife cards that have multiple uses. And while they're trickier to play, they are more rewarding because of their flexibility. And I see this as one of those. An elegant weapon for a more civilized age. So we finally get to the lightsaber. Again, this is a starter deck card. It is a 3-cost neutral card. It has redeploy, which is important. It has 3 damage sides, as well as a shield, a resource, and a blank. It can deal 3 damage for a resource, plus 2 melee damage, and then the special is deal 2 unblockable damage to a character. Now, I truly believe we're going to see a lot of shield-based decks, and so I think the lightsaber, or lightsabers in this case, the non-unique and then the 2 unique ones, are going to see a lot of play, because unblockable damage is going to be important as a way to shoot through shields. You know, we've already seen what Qui-Gon is and what he can do on a defensive side. And you know, there's more. You're going to see more in the Rogues later. And obviously Force users are going to have a lot of ways to get and manipulate shields. So I really think that this is, despite its 3 cost, is going to be a card you want in your Force user decks. Redeploy is important, because it basically says, okay, if the character dies, I get to move this onto another character. And the character that is using it does not have to be blue. Of course, that's very flavorful, since we've seen Finn, who was, I guess, not technically a Force user in A Force Awakens, or The Force Awakens, be able to pick up a lightsaber and try to use it. So, again, Fantasy Flight Games has done a terrific job with the flavor design of this game, for sure. Now, here's another starter deck only card. that I think you're going to certainly want. Mind Probe is a 4-cost ability. It is a neutral, blue character only. It has, technically it has 3 damage sides. It also has a 2 disrupt, a 2 discard, and a blank. The 3 damage sides, one of them is 3 range damage for a resource, and 2 specials. The special reads, deal an opponent's character 1 damage for each card in that opponent's hand. Well, that certainly got tricky. So that obviously your opponent's hand size is going to be 5 cards to start a turn. So the special on this is can be up to 5 damage. Technically, there's another card that increases hand size, which you'll see in a minute. So it could be more. But I'd say even if that wasn't the case, you could still do 3 damage as an average. You would take a card that had 3 damage sides on it, wouldn't you? Yeah, Mind Probe is painful. Now, obviously, it did make the cost 4, so it is going to make you do a little resource checking and thinking before you put it into play. But once it's in play, be prepared for the frontal lobotomy. So now we're going to get into the events. Abandon All Hope is a 2-cost villain event. You get to force an opponent to choose either to lose all of their resources or discard all of the cards in their hand. Now, while this effect is powerful, your opponent gets to choose one of the two. And the bad part about this is they can choose to lose 0 resources or they can choose to discard 0 cards in hand. So this is going to, if you are thinking about putting this card in your deck, what you need to think about is how to properly play this card. You need to play it where it hurts your opponent. If they have 2 or more cards in hand and 2 or more resources in play, either of these effects will hurt them. If they lose all their resources, then they can't play what they were planning on playing. If they discard all their cards, then obviously, not only are they getting themselves closer to decking themselves, but they also can't play what they had in mind. So for me, a card like this is about timing. Both effects are powerful, but knowing when to play it to get the best effect is going to determine how well the card, or how much the card is played. I think better players who better understand how to situationally set up their opponent will be able to play this card to great effect. Ones that don't, it may not be exactly where you something you want to put in your deck, especially if you're a new player. Boundless Ambition is another villain event for 1 resource. Draw cards up to your hand size. So we were talking about at one point that drawing cards in this game, cards that draw cards, we don't really understand where the power level is on these cards because of the way the game is designed, the way the game is played, and the small size of your deck. This is one of the few draw cards effects that I see that can be powerful in the right deck because of some of the other cards that we're going to see in Force Users. There are some powerful blue cards that can cause your opponent a massive amount of damage, more on the villain side than the hero side, so obviously this sort of fits into their plan. So a card like this to be able to refill your hand and deal them a massive amount of what we're calling burst damage, or a huge, which basically is a huge burst amount of a huge amount of damage at once. I could see this type of card getting played. It's sort of a high risk, high reward. It's high risk because you're digging deeper into your deck, which means you could, if your opponent's able to stymie what you're trying to do, or if you're they're trying to, or if you don't draw what you need, then you could be running yourself out of cards, well before you're able to win. The reward is if you draw those cards, you're probably there's a good chance you're going to be either killing your opponent or hampering what he's doing, having him live out on the edge for a very small amount. So Enrage. Enrage is a zero cost villain event. Deal one damage to one of your blue characters to gain a resource. Yes, you are taking an action and playing a card and dealing a damage to one of your characters to gain a resource. But I certainly believe that this is strong enough that is something you probably want in your deck. Damage dealt can be absorbed by shields, so that's important. Gaining the extra resource could allow you to play the correct card to finish off your opponent. So depending on what your deck is, what is your deck is trying to achieve, it's certainly worth a look. Again, I like this in a very aggressive burst damage style deck where you might need a resource or two to finish playing the last couple of cards that you are needing to finish off your opponent on that turn. So yes, I see this card as something that's playable in that kind of style deck. Feel your anger. So this is another villain event for one resource. Count the number of blanks showing on an opponent's dice. Remove that many of their dice. So, dice removal is the most powerful way to deal with opponents, what your opponent's trying to do. This one specifically wants blanks to show up. For this to be effective. You don't have to remove the blank side dice. You can remove the dice that did other things. But removing any number of dice in this manner is a powerful effect. Now, the obviously, again, the question becomes, how many of these type effects are you playing? You'd like to play the ones with little to no restriction before you get to ones like this. That being said, you're going to have to play some number of these style cards in your deck to control what your opponent is rolling or has rolled. And this is a fine card for that. It's not my first pick, but it is certainly in the conversation of control. Now we get to one of the powerful villain events that I was talking about when we're talking about burst damage. Force Strike is a one cost villain event. Turn one of your blue dice to a side showing melee damage, then you may resolve that die. There are a lot of blue cards on the villain side, or the neutral, that are looking to deal 3 damage. So being able to basically use a focus effect, and then resolve a die, in my opinion, is basically like playing 2 different actions for 1 card. In my opinion, that is particularly strong. Again, it's basically like you're taking 2 actions. Those type of effects are the type of effects that swing games, and this one is certainly going in force user aggressive decks, especially in my decks for sure. Intimidate, a 0 cost villain event. Remove all shields from a character. So we ran into, speaking about the Qui-Gon defensive deck, and then there are other cards both in blue and some in yellow that we're going to see that add or have the potential to add a bunch of shields to characters. While you do have to take an action to play this, and while you would rather have cards that deal straight damage to a character, having a card or cards to deal with removing all shields from a character or multiple characters is simply fantastic against those style decks. To me, at least in early deck building, I consider this a card that doesn't quite make the cut. After we've seen how the metagame shakes out, how players build their decks, how many cards they have that add shields and manipulate shields to their advantage, then we may want to start looking at adding a card like this into our deck, 2 copies of it in our deck, etc. The effect is certainly powerful. To me, though, it really focuses on how the metagame is playing. If you're seeing a lot of Qui-Gons and a lot of Han Solos, you're probably playing at least 1 copy of this card, if not 2, if you're playing blue. Alright, Isolation. This is a villain event for 1. Spot a blue character to remove a character die. So, this is... this card is showing a scene from The Empire Strikes Back, where Luke is at the cave at Dagobah, where he faces Vader in a duel, where he cuts off Vader's head, and then the mask explodes and he sees a picture of himself. So a very ominous scene, and this card takes that at that level. Now this is the type of effect that I think, to me, is an auto include in blue based decks. It only deals with a character die. It does not deal with upgrade dice. It does not deal with support dice. But it straight up deals with a character die. So there are a lot of characters. There are some strong support characters that you want to remove their die, and there's some strong main characters that you want to straight up remove their dice. And this is just a nice, easy way to deal with those. It does cost one, and like I said, it is restricted to character dice only. But this is, again, an effect that you want in your deck. Force users are probably the first. This is the group that has the best ways to deal with those dice, and yellow being second. So, no mercy. It's a two-cost event. For villains and an uncommon, discard any number of blue cards from your hand. Then resolve one of your dice showing damage, increasing its value by one for each card you just discarded. Okay, so we were talking about burst damage and aggressive style blue decks a minute ago. You see a character. Say, like a Kylo Ren, like a Darth Vader. Vader has a two damage side and a three damage side on for melee damage. You can now this will cost you two resources, so that's gonna, I mean, that's your entire turn's worth of resources without other cards. But basically what you're doing is trading cards in hand for damage, or blue cards in hand for damage. So you can finish a character out of nowhere. You play this card for two resources, and then you discard, say, two additional cards. So you've spent two resources and three cards to deal three additional damage, or two additional damage, plus the three on your side for five. That's on most characters. That's half or more of their damage, of their health. So that's a huge, that is a humongous chunk. Now, yes, is it going to get you through your deck faster? Probably. But it certainly can, that's pushing a, being able to destroy a character from out of nowhere. That surprise element is what makes this card great. Okay, so next up is another blue villain event. Pull the strings, it costs zero. Look at the top three cards of any deck, then place those cards on the top and or the bottom of that deck in any order. So personally, I see this more as a control card. I can certainly see it being used to help fix your draws if necessary, but I also see it as a way to control what your opponent sees. The biggest problem with the card is, will there be space left in your deck after you get all the normal effects that you want in it? I'm not completely certain that there is a spot for this currently. The control s control the potential and for this being a control card or a manipulation card for you is fairly good, but with the with your opponent being able to go, all right, I can spend all my cards this turn, and then if you put all three of those cards on the bottom, I'm Maybe I see another copy of it when I redraw my hand. So this is not a certainty by any means. The Emperor's Favor. This is a one-cost villain support card. It is unique. Your hand size is increased by one. So I don't see this going in a lot of decks, although it does give you more options as far as draw back to hand size. So I draw back to five. I draw back to six instead of five. You get to draw more with Boundless Ambition. And you get to do some really disgusting things with No Mercy. So if you're trying to build a very combo-ish deck around those type of cards, then this is an effect you're looking for. You will run out of cards before your opponent playing this style. So it's either kill them quickly or lose. But it's certainly an effect in that style, in a combo-ish style deck, that this is useful in. I don't know how many other strategies are going to want it. I could be totally wrong. Again, this card drawing, hand size, there's a lot of questions that we, even with all seeing all the cards, without seeing how the full meta shakes out, it's questionable. It may be a very powerful effect, and we may be judging it completely wrong. You do not understand the power of the dark side. So this is a two-cost support card. It's a starter deck villain-only card. Action, exhaust the support to reroll one of your dice. If you roll a blank, deal two unblockable damage to a character. So, despite the cost of two, this is basically a card that gives you a free reroll as an action and basically makes any of your blanks when you use this a two unblockable damage. To me, this is a card that I would certainly look at as an effect. You want dice manipulation. You want to remove your opponent's dice, manipulate your opponent's dice. You want to manipulate your own dice in some way, if possible, and then you would go to something like this that is a reroll. Being able to effectively change all the blank sides on that die to two unblockable damage is remarkable. And since almost every card has a blank side, you're basically with a copy or two of this in play, any reroll that is basically adding an additional side to that die. And it basically says, okay, cool. I reroll this die. Oh, I hit a blank. Okay, deal two unblockable damage. And then if it's on a card like Immobilize, not only did you get two extra damage and you rolled a blank, now you can remove the die. To use Immobilize's ability and get even more value. So I expect to see a lot of this card in dark side force user decks. Next up is Hidden in Shadow, and I apologize about the glare. One cost, ability upgrade, villain only. Action, if attached character has no shields, exhaust this upgrade to give it one shield. So Earlier, I was talking about Count Dooku, and even Night Sisters. This is the type card you'd want in that style deck. You've got Dooku, who you can discard a card to add a shield when he's about to be hit, and you have a card like this that, as an action, adds a shield. So he can constantly be adding shields to himself, protecting himself, making him very difficult to kill. And with Night Sisters, you have the built-in reroll and deals of damage, so you can literally burn the shield to reroll a die, and then use hidden in shadow. So there's a lot of practical applications for a card like this. Now, it can go on any character, so you can put it, as long as you have a blue character in your starting lineup, in your deck building process, you can play this card, so it'll go on anybody. But that's just an application that I've seen that's worked really well. Now on to the hero side. Anticipate. Two resources. Event. Force an opponent to choose and reroll, to choose and resolve any number of their dice in the order of their choice. Then remove all of their dice that they did not resolve. So you're basically giving them the ability to take multiple actions to resolve any of their dice. But at the end of those, you remove all the dice that didn't resolve. So in other words, all of their dice are going to resolve that they have in their pool, period. This is a card that I push into a pile that says, the better player that you are, the better this card gets. This really takes in things like a good use of anticipate will make the card feel almost broken, and then so it's a skill intensive card. So better players are going to get better use out of this card. Defensive stance. This is a common hero event for one resource. Give a character two shields. You'll notice Qui-Gon is already in his defensive stance, and he's probably going to use one of those shields and hit you for one. Light side characters are use shields in a variety of ways, both as protection and as damage. You'll see another card here later that gets into that. And you want a number of defensive style cards in your deck. This is auto slotting into a Qui-Gon deck. It's probably going to slot into other blue decks as well on the hero side. There is a gray card that does a similar effect, but only gives one shield. And I would think you would play this card over that one, except a Qui-Gon deck, we'd probably play both. But yeah, you're going to be very annoyed with shields if you're playing a lot of blue decks and some yellow ones. So be prepared, you're going to see it. Force Misdirection. It's a hero card that costs one. Choose a symbol showing on one of your blue dice. Then remove all of an opponent's dice showing that symbol. Okay, so I think this one is better than a card like It's a Trap, from in my opinion. From the red cards, because you're choosing one of your blue dice showing a side to remove all of your opponent's dice showing that same symbol. Now you will have a little more you'll have a bit of a problem if your opponent is playing range damage and you're playing melee damage. As typical force users are going to be melee damage, because that's a side that's not going to be on a lot of red cards, and it will be on some yellow cards. But being able to remove multiple of an opponent's dice, especially ones that are showing a positive effect, really mess with an opponent's plans. Normally you'd be spending one card or one action to get rid of a single die. This can get rid of, has the potential to get rid of multiple cards. And so that's where the power level effect of this card is important. It's a little meta dependent, simply because if you're playing a blue deck in a field of red and yellow, you might not get as much use out of it. It may be a little more situational than if you're playing in a blue heavy meta, because there are a lot of matching sides on both sides. But it is still a strong use of this type of effect. Heroism is a zero-cost hero event. Deal one of your unique characters damage equal to the value of an opponent's die showing damage, then remove that die. So again, this falls under the protection element. It falls under the dice removal element. Especially the shield heavy deck with Qui-Gon, this card is straight nuts, because you're basically removing, you're dealing the damage to his shields and pointing that damage away from your secondary character, your support character. So obviously it fits the theme of what heroism is and what the Jedi do for a living. All right, Noble Sacrifice. So Noble Sacrifice is a zero cost hero event. Defeat one of your blue characters to exhaust a character. Now, I am not completely sold on this card, because for me the cost is too high. It's not an effect you want early game. This to me is a late game effect, where you have where you are trying to aggressively protect one of your characters, trying to keep your opponent from getting the last points of damage in, so that you can either, so that you can deck them or finish them off with the right amount of damage. Where you can sacrifice a character that's almost dead, but not, you know, obviously not completely. It's very situational. I'm not 100% sure. So again, I'm not completely sure where this is going to go. Except for maybe a late game control deck. Patience. This is a hero event. It costs one. You get to remove any number of your dice. Then discard cards from the top of an opponent's deck equal to the number of dice just removed. So the defensive control decks that are looking to mill an opponent out, this is the type deck that this goes in. I really don't think it may not, probably does not go in any other deck. The Qui-Gon Padme deck that I've been working on, this is a card that's in it. You can remove a big number of dice, and being able to mill five cards off the top of their deck is great. Now, obviously, The problem of with this card is removing any number of your dice. When you're, if you're at the point where you've been unable to get the sides that you've wanted, you can, it's very easy to spend this card and remove those dice and say, hey, you know what, I'm gonna mill some cards off your deck, and we'll go from here. But there certainly is a danger to it. But the way that you turtle up and can keep a big number of shields on your characters, I certainly think that that's the only style deck it goes in. Anything else is not going to be able to remove any number of your dice to do an effect like this without being very detrimental to your strategy. Return of the Jedi. One cost hero event. Add a blue event from your discard pile to your hand. It's very simple. It's some amount of recursion for particular events, blue events. It's a hero only card, so it's restrictive to hero only, obviously, which makes the that'll limit what you can get back with it. There are decks that can't have this type of effect in it that may like some amount of recursion. But right now, as I've gone through the spoilers, gone through the cards, I don't know if this is going to fit in anything right now. I really don't. The future potential of it is much better than the current potential of it. Riposte is a zero cost hero event. Remove any number of your shields from one of your characters. Then deal damage to a character equal to the number of shields you just removed. So the decks like Qui-Gon that can stack shield after shield after shield on him. He, besides having the base ability to take a shield off to ping somebody when you gain a shield, it also has the ability to drop three shields to hit something for three. Now, we were talking about burst damage from the dark side. The light side can do this trick too. They just have to burn shields to do it. It's, again, another powerful effect out of nowhere that your opponent has no knowledge of. So the shield heavy decks, this is a quick way to finish off a character before they realize that they can do that, that you can do it. So this is another card that I look at for those style decks. I say we'll play the turtle game, and then we'll be like, and we'll slowly ping you, get a damage here and there, and then all of a sudden, oh, you're down to this. Okay, I'll blow all my shields to kill to defeat your character. All right, Willpower. This is another hero effect. One resource event. Move one damage from one of your exhausted characters to an opponent's exhausted character. This ignores shields. So, in the same vein as the shields being a protective element, this card is both has protection ability, as well as having an ability to deal damage to your opponent, ignoring shields, and being able to move damage around from one of your characters to one of their characters, is, again, another huge swing. You can easily move one of your a damage from your exhausted character to your opponent's exhausted character, and it finish a character off. This fits in with more the defensive style light side decks, as sort of a surprise I gotcha card to help you heal or turtle up while still dealing them some amount of damage. Jedi Council. 2-cost support for heroes. Exhaust this support to look at the top 2 cards of a player's deck. Then you may discard one of those cards and have that player draw the other card. So, again, the idea of knowledge is power. You get to see the top 2 cards of a player's deck, either yours or your opponent's. You get to deny them having one of those cards, but they get the other card. Or you can choose the best card for you and then discard that the other card. This sort of has the double-edged sword effect on both. If you use it on yourself, you're 2 cards deeper into your deck, which can be a negative, but you do get some sort of selection. And if you use it on your opponent, you have essentially removed a card from their deck, but you've also given them a card. So right now I think it's questionable how much this sees play, because again, the card drawing aspect is a very difficult thing to judge right now in this game. There has been an awakening. So this is a 1-cost support. It is a for heroes only. It is a starter deck card. Exhaust the support to resolve one of your dice, showing a modified side, in this case a side with a plus, as if it were not modified. So this basically is a support that makes your plus melee or plus ranged damage or plus whatever side it is, as long as it has a plus on it, you can resolve it as though it didn't have that. It's non-unique, and it is something for dice manipulation that especially if you're running a deck with more of the modified sides than you would normally want to run, this is a card to help mitigate that. Rey is a character that has multiple modified side dice, so she's a little more scary when you roll her dice because she doesn't have, it's not guaranteed, where this helps mitigate some of that. And if you've built your deck with more of those sides than you'd like, then this is certainly something that I would look at. The Force is strong. 1-cost hero support. Action. Exhaust the support and discard a blue card from hand to play another copy of that card from your hand for free. So I'm just going to go ahead and say that, considering the fact that you're only allowed 2 copies of a card in your deck, that it's going to be very difficult for this card to see play. I would almost put this in the Banta fodder pile. Yeah, this is going to be one of those actions that, with only restricted to 2 copies of a card in a deck, I just don't see this played. I don't think it's worth what you have to do to get it to work. Next up is Deflect. One cost event, spot a blue character to remove a die showing range damage and deal half of that damage rounded up to a character. This is a card that I expect to see play, especially in red and yellow heavy environments where there's a lot of range damage. Because not only does it remove a die, it also deals half of that damage back to another character. If you're in a range damage heavy environment, you'll probably play two of this card in a blue heavy deck. And if you're not, you may cut it down to one, or you may cut it all together. So this is, to me, it's a meta dependent card, but it's a very strong meta dependent card. Disturbance in the Force, a one cost neutral event, reroll all dice. It's a simple card, simple ability, not hard to figure out. Very magic-esque in its simplicity. It is a card you'll see in the starter deck, so it may be an effect you've already played. Again, this is a card that is dependent on many different factors, but it's skill intensive. The better player you are, the better this card becomes. Now again, you want, in my opinion, you want more dice removal and dice manipulation cards before you get to a card that says reroll, simply because you like to forcefully change effects, because a reroll gives them another chance to hit a better same side or a better side. But it's not one you're completely unhappy with. Mind Trick. This is a two-cost event, neutral, spotty blue character to force an opponent to split their dice pool into two groups of any size. You choose one group and remove all of their dice in it. If they only have one dice in their pool, this card basically will allow you to remove their dice, that die. If they have three dice in that pool, you're going to get to remove two dice. If they have an odd number of dice, this is going to have the ability to remove more dice. So if your opponent has 10 dice in their pool, you're going to get to remove 5 of them. Again, this is another skill-intensive card. You have to properly set up. Your opponent has to know how to split their dice up correctly. And it can reward you for an opponent putting the wrong, putting too many good dice in the right, in one pool or another. But it's still a massive amount of dice removal. Now, two is expensive for an event. So you can get caught with this card in your hand and not have enough resources. But when you are able to play a card like this, it is powerful at removing a number of so many dice. Be wary that this card does exist. I'm not sure. I know a lot of players talked about this card can be a blowout if played at the right time, so that's the reason I consider it a skill-intensive card. The Power of the Force. one resource neutral card. Resolve one of your dice, treating its value as equal to the number of blue upgrades you have in play. So, let's see. If you have a 2 force users, but you have 2 characters in play with 3 blue upgrades each, you can resolve a die as having 6, being the number 6. We were talking about burst damage earlier. Being able to change a die from a 3 to a 6 is, again, more damage out of nowhere. Now this is a neutral card, so you can see it out of either side. And I actually see this as sort of a reach card for the light side. It allows them to get the burst damage. Helps them with getting burst damage through. But it also combos very well with the dark side and the aggressive upgrade heavy Sith Holocron style decks. You will be seeing this at least from the dark side and probably from the light side as well, in a lot of blue heavy decks going forward. This is a neutral card. It's in the starter decks. Use the Force. 1 cost. Spot a blue character to turn a die to any side. So this is a card that can be used both proactively and reactively. Since it can be used on your dice or your opponent's dice. And that type of versatility is something that you look for in a card to be multi-purposed when you have only 30 slots in a deck. Yes, your opponent can then mess with whatever you do. So let's say they rolled a 3 damage side and you swapped it to a blank side. Your opponent can do something else to manipulate that die again. So you're using it reactively, or you could roll a blank and change it to a 3. You roll your die as a blank and then have to change it to a 3 damage side. So in either situation, your opponent has to now find a way to react again. So this is the type of card I expected to see out of Force users. It makes perfect sense, and it is a card you will see a lot of going forward. And the last blue card in the Awakening set is It Binds All Things. It is a neutral event for 1 resource, or neutral support card, I'm sorry, for 1 resource. Before you play a blue upgrade, you may exhaust the support to decrease its cost by 1. So free resources are very powerful in most games. In a game where both players have a fixed number of resources each turn, two apiece normally, they have ways to roll additional resources or gain additional resources. This is a card that's going to go in, again, blue, heavy upgrade style decks. The Sith Holocron decks on the dark side don't need it as much, but as a card like this going in the blue light side deck is invaluable, where you can decrease a lightsaber's cost by 1. If you're playing it on a Padawan, you can all, if it doesn't happen, and upgrade, you can decrease it by one again. So you can drop a lightsaber from a 3-cost upgrade to a 1-cost upgrade. Without having to discard an upgrade on that character. So essentially being able to save you costs is very is a is an effect that decks that are using a lot of higher cost cards may want to pack. This obviously costs one, so on the first turn that you play it, it's going to cost you a resource. After the first time you use it, it's already paid you back. The next time you use it, it has netted you a resource, etc. And you can have two copies of this in play, and both of them will trigger, so you can reduce. If you had two copies in play with a Padawan in play, the lightsaber would cost you 0 resources if it didn't have a weapon on it already. Decks that are tight on resource costs and play a lot of upgrades or play a specific number of upgrades, they can't really discard their upgrades. This is a card they're going to look toward to help them save some of the resources for some of their other effects. Okay, so that is all the blue cards from the Awakening set. Again, I was your host, Bradley Reeves. You can find us at the colotinformant.com. We do have a Facebook page. We are also on Twitter at colot_informant. I will have links to the other videos in the description below. I'm doing one on each of the different colors in the set. So don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. And may the force be with you.